star Simon Le Bon and the crew of his capsized yacht have been saved from gale-force seas off the south coast. Le Bon, lead singer in the pop group Duran Duran, was trapped inside his...
frightening, loud bang.
...turned over while competing in the Fastnet Race. They were rescued by...
Such a freak accident, beyond belief.
...the rescue of Le Bon and his crew took place 2 miles off the coast of Cornwall. One report says the keel fell off his yacht.
Simon Le Bon, the lead singer of pop legends Duran Duran, announced his plans to race the Maxi yacht DRUM once again this summer by entering the world-famous Rolex Fastnet Race on the 7th of August and to reunite with the original crew from 1985.
I think it's more about going for a sail with old friends. It's about doing the race that we never finished. And it's also about raising some money for the RNLI, who were a very big part of the rescue. Sir Arnold Clarke, who's lending us the boat very kindly, has also, he's auctioning a car, a Ford car, to raise money for the RNLI in conjunction with the event. I think the idea is for us to finish the race and to have a good time with friends. But we're all very competitive people, so we are going to be pushing the boat as fast as we feel it's safe to push her.
Siders on the boat, but the soles was just about completely wore out. You could see through the soles on them. And what we used to do was we used to rotate the man onto the traveller. And when you went onto the traveller and you needed a new pair of shoes, so you used to put on this old pair of Docksiders and get back and lean back and pull on the traveller and put it up like that, and the old man would see him. And then after the race, he'd come on and come over to you and he'd tap you on the shoulder until he'd give you a bunch of wad of notes and tell you to piss off down the road and get yourself a pair of new shoes.
After sailing from Liverpool, DRUM is moored at the East Cowes Marina. Here the crew will have ample time to make their final preparations and any minor repairs to DRUM.
Searching for the needle in the haystack. Screw loose. There's one missing.
An important one.
I should have put it in here 20 years ago.
We have one compass light out. We have a life raft hatch that one big wave, it could wash over the side. We've got to secure the gas bottle. Now that's very important, because if the gas bottle goes, we won't be cooking.
What is it? What do you do?
It's a bilge pump. It's got to be operational at 10 degrees of heel. It doesn't look like it's been operational for quite a few years. But
How's your nose in it, one on each ear? Get your nose up in there. You have to learn to breathe through your ears, wouldn't you?
Friends of my parents who knew nothing about sailing, you say DRUM and say, ah, oh, that's the boat that pop star had that the keel fell off. And so it's very interesting. And of course, one of the questions we're always asked every day when we go out in corporate charter is the keel going to fall off then? And this winter, I've been so fed up last season answering that question, that this winter we took the keel off just to see what condition the boats were in. And I have to report now they are absolutely immaculate. And I'm confident now that the keel will not fall off.
Now, on to the gentleman we have on board.
Ah, the Space Cowboys. Yes, I recall watching a film many years ago called Space Cowboys, and where the old guys come back in and show the young guys how it's done. And this could be one of those episodes.
The crew took the opportunity for a photo call to highlight the importance of the RNLI and a chance for them to meet up with one of the original rescue teams and swap a few stories. Remember, a lot of these guys haven't seen each other for some 20 years, and are looking forward with some trepidation and eagerness to this new challenge. As the call-shot lifeboat departs for its home port, the boys make their way to the reunion dinner at Upper Fox's house, the perfect place to watch the aerial display.
I think this is fated. He's going to do an air display now. So whenever the idea was made, I thought, oh yes, sounds good fun. And then I began to think of it, and I just thought, I remember drum machine, put them in hardware. It's damned uncomfortable. I've done Fastnet races. I don't need to do it anymore. And I actually don't want to go. I'll not enjoy it. But it was almost harder to face up and admit that and wimp out, if you like. The easy thing was to go, would have been to go along and say, yeah, I'll come, not enjoy it, and then collect the T-shirt at the end. Well, I just thought I got enough T-shirts. So, and the wimp, I'm doing the dinner.
Unfortunately, a few of the original crew of 85 were unable to attend the reunion dinner.
The only reason I'm here is I've only ever been to one Oz crew party, and that was the Thursday night before we all went. And I sailed with you guys a couple of times in Cowdery, and Skip said, we're one short till you come on the Fastnet. And that's the last invitation I accepted. So we're all going over, if you remember. The boat was at Hamble, and we got into this launch being driven by a lifeboat coxswain who spotted all our wimpy yachties and started to tell us tales of heavy weather. And if you remember, Chaz, he said, well, you know, you guys go on the boat, you know, on the Fastnet, right? We go out in the lifeboat and weather like this all the time. All the time. You ever seen weather like this? Not much response. People just sit away. And he turned to Chaz and he said, what about you, mate? You ever gone out in a lifeboat? You ever gone out in a lifeboat, have you? And Chaz looked at him and he says, no, I've come back in a couple, but I've never gone out.
We've got to mention the guys who actually got us off the boat. And that is the Royal Naval Air Station at Coldroves and the RNLI, who between them got our asses off that hull and onto dry land. Thank you.
I'm really sorry I can't be there this evening. I'm sure it's going to be an absolutely fantastic evening. However, I'm there in spirit. So that just remains for me to say, cheers guys, Godspeed, may the winds be with you and have a fantastic time. Bon voyage.
Phil and I had the idea with Pascal. The one person who's put more effort into this than anybody else is Phil Wade. Yeah.
Well, boys, here I am at 75 degrees north, stuck in the Northwest Passage. Of course, the Northwest Passage will always still be here, but the drum reunion is a one-off thing, and I have to regret that I'm not going to make it. I'm not going to surprise you guys tonight by bursting in through the door in a polar bear costume. And it's a pity because I was, you know, I've seen some of you over the years regularly, but I haven't seen quite a few for many, many years. And I was very interested to see the bald heads and the graying hairs and the complaints of this, that, and the other. But I want to wish you all the best in the Fastnet race. I'll be watching your progress out there. And one hand for the boat, as always.
I really appreciate being here. I didn't want to get chucked out, but I just got sucked out once again.
Chaz brought over from Tasmania a very large ripe local cheese, which of course came with a story.
So what were we talking about? My cheese. I was given this to bring across here to produce at this dinner time. Shipway and all those blokes took me out to the airport, put it in, and they said, when you have that drum party, because all those blokes, they know you, all the Aussies, and they said, for Christ's sake, make sure the cheese, and I had the cheese, and the cheese was here, and the cheese was there, and I was running around, and they thought it was a bomb when I got there. And it's heavy, too, it looks like it's going to blow up.
After dinner, they enjoyed the traditional end of Cowes Week firework display, together with the reenactment of the Battle of Trafalgar. Started in 1925, the 608-mile Fastnet Race starts from Cowes on the Isle of Wight, along the south coast of England, past Land's End, then up to the south coast of Ireland, rounding the Fastnet Rock, and back to the finish in Plymouth. With good weather, approximately 3 days. With all repairs completed and the essential liquid supplies, as well as food taken on, it won't be long before they head off towards the start.
My mother came from the Isle of Wight, and she came from a big sailing family. When I was a small boy, I was brought up in Australia, and we lived beside the sea, and we all had boats, and we sailed, and fish, everything was on the water. I was very keen on sailing, but I didn't ever think that I was going to embark on a sailing career. It just happened. It fell into its place. It's very unexpected coming here to DRUM. I just spent 4 years after a horrendous accident, and so I was a year in hospital, and I broke my leg 6 places, and so when I got out, I went out and I worked out in the Barrier Reef on one of the pontoons with all the tourists and that. I'm still working out, but I didn't ever expect to come back and do this, but anyway, it's great to be back and see all the guys and see everything that's going on.
Good warm feeling, camaraderie, you know, special. You don't experience that too many times in your life. Certainly we had it. I can think of a few times where we've been privileged enough to have great camaraderie. Once was with Duran, 7 of us during the first 8 years of their career. And of course the support team around us. And then on DRUM, it's rare to find that level of richness, I think, in the relationships.
Reunion in Cowes, I'll never make that, because I was on it back, but I made a miraculous recovery and just got on the plane and here I am. Sort of a last minute decision, really. When you have a sort of major medical trauma coming out the other side, you sort of feel reborn. So you're likely to take a couple of risks.
So I've either got to send someone up or bring it down.
The closest part of the line to the next port is on the island side. The tide should be at a third of this time. We're going to check the tide now. Yeah. And then we have to leave the Duran Boy to port. And there is a boy called Scott at the first cross. So we leave the port. We go out to east of the Shingles.
Yeah, it's kind of emotional coming back on the old boat because I spent a lot of time on it, especially in different phases. One in the Fastnet, the second phase was doing the Whitbread, and then the third phase was cruising around on it for a year with Simon and the other owners. So I've seen it in 2 or 3 different phases. So I think in a lot of ways it probably means more to me than most of the other guys on board.
Just generally speaking on the boat, I mean, guys have been brilliant, I can tell you, but just got to take things easy on the old girl and she'll take it easy on us, and you know, play it safe.
Phil? We only have the one pole, you know, the starboard pole's not working. The end fitting shot up inside of it.
What's it like seeing guys again?
That's good fun. It almost feels like I left them, you know, a week ago. So it's pretty strange. Everybody's got kids and family and all this and that, but they're still the same guys.
With great anticipation, the crew of Drum are preparing to jibe and head towards the start line, which they did 20 years ago, except this time they intend to finish.
I think it's a combination of the attraction of being on, boat is for me very much that this is a very simple life. It's you get away from all the social bullshit ashore and all the complexity of modern society. So it's an escape in one way, in that way perhaps. But also it's a nice feeling to be with a group of people on a boat, because things get very simple, and what is important is the relationship between people and help each other in all kinds of situations. Like, for example, this is what happened with Drum. So the more core values in the human being gets extracted.
10 seconds. 8 seconds. 6, 5.
Roger counts down the final seconds to the start of the race. All 281 yachts, including Drum, navigate their way through the press and spectator boats.
Let's try trimming your fill now. Obviously.
It's always a worry, the first hoist.
This 77-foot Maxi may be 20 years old, but she still has the elegance and grace and lines of a thoroughbred.
So the time is now 16:50, it's 4.5 hours in, so the fastest race on the old Drum boat, and we are just heading out offshore here from Isle of Wight. We stayed on starboard tack. In the beginning the wind was very flimsy from the north, and we both stayed close to the mainland shore in the Solent.
Many years ago, there was a nightclub in London which we all used to go to, the Blue Angel, which was in Berkeley Square, and that's where Dave Allen first made his stage appearance. And in those days, apparently, I did look very, very like him, and I used to go in there all the time, and he and I became quite good pals. There was one evening when I went on stage instead of him, telling his jokes. But most everybody was so pissed they didn't notice anyway.
Long wave.
Everybody used to have those.
This is the way we, that's all the way to get the weather or something. 20 years ago, we have to do the same way, you know? No internet, no satellite communication. Long way. BBC 4.
Acting barman today is Terry, who's preparing cocktails before dinner. The food on this trip differs from the previous time they were together. On this occasion, it was prepared by Anne, Phil Wade's wife. But, of course, Phil received all the credit.
I think you're fine after tomorrow. It's not a big deal.
No, exactly.
Because everybody, you know...
No, but you discuss it with everybody. Yeah. That's
right. See you tomorrow. Thanks for dinner, Phil. It's great.
Is there any more, Phil?
Yeah.
A lot of people always ask you if you get scared at sea, and you can honestly say that no, you never get scared. You might get an adrenaline rush, or you might get on edge and more alert, but I can't, in all honesty, I can't say I've ever been frightened or scared, because if something happens like on sailing, it always happens very quickly, that you don't have time to be scared. You just, and I think when you've been doing it a long time, you get into the frame of mind where you're prepared. So if anything does go wrong, you can always remedy it as quick as possible.
the drum project was there to be done, and Simon, we all wanted a break from the Duran Duran in about 1985, and we thought, you know, it would be a good idea to pick up that project, because Rob James had tragically died, and he built the hull and nothing else really, and we took that project over and decided to do the Whitbread as a form of therapy from rock and roll. And so we built, had the boat built, put a project together with a really good team of people, good project managers, great crew, all very exciting. Came to Cowes Week in the Maxi series, and to our amazement we won that, which was probably came too easily really, because we just came to Cowes, won the racing against the other Whitbread boats. It was only round the cans, but we won that, ended up with a big cup at the Royal Yacht Squadron, and we all thought, oh, this is good fun.
It was our first day of the Fastnet Race, 85. 23 guys on board the boats. I think it was it was officially a force 5, 12 to 15 knots of wind, something like that. So not really heavy weather, and it was not, the sea was, there was a kind of swell. It was not choppy. It's just kind of, it was a bit bumpy, a bit of a bumpy sea, but not like a horror, not like an awkward shock that would knock the back of the boat around. So it's quite comfortable sailing with tracking. The boat tracked really beautifully in that kind of sea.
Well,
if
we're going to go with the guy, we've got more pressure, we can bear away. Plenty of pressure here, Simon, to start bearing off. There you go, that's nice.
Well, we were sailing along, pretty breezy day, close hauled on the coast of Cornwall, and I was down below with Roger, in the navigation station way back aft.
Yeah, can you? Yeah, no, I'll have to give you a big ease. Trim on a little, trim on.
Well, I remember it was blowing fairly hard. I think we were down to number 4 and 3 reefs, but it was fairly flat seas because we were in off of Falmouth. And at the time, I remember I was down in my bunk asleep because I was off what we were practicing a good watch system for before the Whitbread.
And everything seemed to be okay, so I thought, oh, I'm going to go off watch and get some kit while it's comfortable. Not before the weather might kick in, it might get a bit ugly.
You know, plenty of water under us. Sailing along, didn't even have life jackets on, most of us.
I think I'm the only person who can say I was actually wearing a life jacket on board when we capsized. And not because I was feared it, but in fact I'd been given this special life jacket on test, and I thought, well, the Fastnet Race has got to be an obvious test for it, so I was wearing it. In fact, because it was comfortable and it made a nice pillow.
I was just coming off watch and I was standing down in the companionway. I can remember the generator was on. We had a huge, big pressure cooker on, hissing away on the stove, and the boat was pounding to weather.
And all of a sudden I heard a loud bang, and I thought, Christ, the rig's gone.
With a second bang, the bow rode up as though we'd actually run onto something. But it was really just the releasing of the lead.
Sort of realized, it's not the rig, probably the keel.
I put the helm down to try and back the sails, and nothing happened, and that gave us a pretty good idea of really what was about to unfold.
And it was watch change. There were very few of us on deck, and everybody that should have been on deck was late getting up.
85 when the boat capsized. I was up in that bunk and heard the helmsman call out that there was a loud bang.
The first thing I remember was that there was a big noise in the boat from water, streaming into the boat, and people screaming and shouting.
It seemed in slow-mo. You know, a car crash, everything goes slow motion. It's a bit like that.
Thank you.
sure of the situation reared its ugly head as Skip Novak from the back screamed, "Everybody out, lads! It's everyone for himself!"
And I shouted to the boys, I said, "The rig's gone," and I headed for the hatch. I was the first one out of the hatch. I don't know what happened behind me, but when I came on deck, the boat was over on its side almost.
The boat slowly was on its side, and then it started to turn turtle. And as it did this, I had a fantastic view out of the hatch. I could see the sky, a bit of land, and the sea. And then I could see the land, the sea, and then I could see the sea. And the sea just turned kind of a greenish loom, and the light came back up through the companionway.
The deck was wet and it had slipped off, so I stood on the coffee grinder pedestal and then tried to get the life raft locker open. We found afterwards that I got about 5.5 of the 9 latches off undone. And Phil Wade came out the hatch in front of me. I think he was the first one out. He tried to help me as well from the other direction. Eventually it became apparent that we weren't going to get the raft lid off. And so we had to swim out underneath where the lifelines, as this sort of this jaw came down over the top of us.
My wife and I were in the water together, my brother. And seriously considering that this was probably the end. You know, this time we've really done it.
And there was people jumping out of the hatch as quickly as possible, but a lot, it was obvious not all of them were going to get out. It happened too quick.
John was standing next to me, climbed through the lifelines, and as the boat rolled, just climbed onto the bottom of the boat. And from that position, was able to actually get a rope to drag the other guys up, which would have been pretty difficult. Had someone not got to the bottom of the boat, it would have been almost impossible to climb back on.
By the time I got to the hatch, the boat was 90 degrees, water pouring through, and we were like trout trying to swim upstream.
The pressure cooker that we had, hissing away, took off, bouncing around the inside of the boat, this boiling hot piece of metal hissing.
It was literally every man for himself. I remember Phil Wade yelling at everybody, "Get out! Everybody get out! Get out!"
And the pressure inside the boat seemed to increase, and water started coming in, so I thought that perhaps the boat might be just about ready to go down.
And I managed to get out and watch the deck basically come right over on top of me. And I was sort of scrambled out of the way, and I literally caught the rail of the boat and like a lid on a coffin, and I was outside.
Took my jacket off, cast that aside, and jumped down through the hatch, feet first, and then began to try and swim from the hatch under the boat and to the top side, which was obviously my way of freedom. And I immediately was confronted by all the ropes and cables that were hanging down, which I got a bit caught up in for a while, and instead of sinking down as I thought I might, because my foul weather gear was still on my bottoms, I floated straight back up towards the deck, and I was kind of pinned towards the deck.
My thinking was, Jesus, if we're out here for hours, you're gonna catch a death of cold sitting on top of the hull. If that's where you're, or you're gonna be in the water. We didn't know anything. We didn't know that they even gone to the hull.
I had to surface. I did indeed take some seawater in, and it stopped me from breathing for a while. But when I popped up, I was drowning. I had no air in my lungs, and I had seawater, and my esophagus had just snapped shut like a trapdoor.
And I looked around, and all of a sudden heads start popping up out of the water everywhere. Chaz the Taz was right next to me, and he popped up with a big smile on his face. My God, he says, "Survived another disaster," had a look on his face to say.
The generator was still going, and of course it was pouring out black smoke by then in our faces. So we swam away behind the boat a little bit, and very quickly I got very tired. I had duct tape around the tops of my boots, and I tried to kick them off, and of course they came half off and full of water, and then I couldn't get them back on. I really thought we were done for. Well, certainly I thought I was.
The next thing that Phil Wade bobs to the surface just beside me, and I thought, well, that's reassuring, you know. Phil looks at me and he just says, "Have you ever done this before?"
I can remember having my head in the air thinking, I can't believe this. I've managed to survive this far, but I'm going to drown with my head in the air. It was with a great deal of irony, I think, at that moment.
Suddenly a horseshoe life buoy popped up in front of us, and Yoni got his right arm around it, and I got my left arm around it, and we sort of lay on our backs, and immediately became apparent, well, if this boat sinks now, we might be the only two survivors. And we sort of lay on our backs and kicked away from the boat, and we got about 15 or 20 feet away, and suddenly it wouldn't go any further.
And then a big wave hit me and threw me on the side of the boat and threw me up right next to Chaz, and the force of that actually forced me to cough and start choking, and choked and vomited, and then I started breathing, but my lungs were so sore they were burning with the salt in the water.
And we discovered that there was a line from the Horseshoe Life Buoy, which is a fine polypropylene splice about this long that you couldn't have undone with your teeth even if you tried. And that right line went down to the pulpit of the boat, down underwater. So I said, oh my God, what's going to happen now? And next thing Yanni says, oh, hang on a minute. And there's a blade of a buck knife about this long, like in front of me here. And he cuts the string and away we swim again.
And I remember grabbing because the boat was upside down, grabbing the wire rail, which was now inverted, and putting my feet on it just to hold on to something. And as the boat rolled away, you'd be sort of 3 feet out of the water, and then you took a deep breath and the boat would roll back on top of you. So you just went, I didn't want to let go of the boat because I'd be swept away into the ocean.
And then I looked at everyone who was on the bottom of the boat, and my fear was, where's my brother? That was my instant feeling. Where's my brother? Where's my brother? He's not here. And that's when I really started to get scared.
And when I clambered up there, Phil was lighting a cigarette. It was amazing.
I wanted something to warm myself up, and I'm not normally smoking, but I got he lit the Marlboro cigarette because he had his Marlboro cigarettes in his pocket and they were all dry. I think it was Phil Holland, I'm not sure. And so I got a cigarette and just inhaled the warm smoke. It was feeling very good.
And then I remember talking through the outlet of the head, screaming down because the loo was inverted upside down. Somebody had been on the loo. I forget who it was. So he had a funny experience because he was just about to finish and it was upside down and everything in the loo tipped all over.
Sort of shouting down through there so they could hear us. And we got the wrong number and we thought, there's somebody's missing, you know, somebody unaccounted for.
That was all. And immediately I just thought, oh no, we've lost two people. One of which I thought was Simon, because Simon hadn't been accounted for shouting through the loo.
And then we heard screaming. Well, the sails were along the passageway here, and as the boat rolled, the bunk rolled up against the side of the vessel, a 400-pound mainsail fell in on covering. The smallest crew member of the boat, Max, went in and managed to pull the sail away from the bunk. The water was getting very close to him anyway, so he was quite concerned, screaming for his life.
I think they finally heard my voice under the sail, and they heard someone was there, and they came back.
Very frightening to hear it, and it absolutely fired us into action. We belted to the back of the boat.
Neil Chest, with just such presence of mind, went to the galley, grabbed a knife, cut the lashings of the bunk.
He was holding the knife with the blade, and he was cutting with the other side. And I went through, and I tell you the truth, it was very, very close.
Once we got the sail away and got him out, and accounted for 18 out on deck and 6 of us inside, we knew that everybody was accounted for.
Obviously, we knew somebody had seen us because we had boats around us in the race and people on the cliff walking in, so rescue came pretty quick, luckily.
They were sailing before that quite calm because my son-in-law's father was actually watching him through binoculars when she capsized. And he blinked, and he couldn't believe his eyes when he looked back, and their boat was upside down.
Then the helicopter came.
first thing we knew was we heard the helicopter, and the next, and then 5 minutes later, up pops this guy in a wetsuit and an oxygen rebreather. Takes off his mask. Jesus, what have you guys been smoking in here?
We saw this, I think it was Larry, the diver, coming up and say, how many of you guys are around? And we're like, probably six. And I remember all this phrase was like, I'll be back. And we're like, oh, cool.
Found two holds. One which was full of rope, which I didn't go inside in case I got myself trapped. And I went to another one, flipped back the hatch cover, and I went inside the air pocket, and there was six standing there. Up to about waist-deep in water.
And Terry Good going back for his philo facts before the diver swam him out of the boat.
I've never been so glad to be flying through the air on the end of a rope. And I remember dropping in a field in Falmouth. It was just a green field, and I put my feet down, no shoes or anything. I landed in a cow path, my both feet went into it, and it was just heavenly, warm cow path. Oh, it was lovely.
I thought I was going to have to go in the lifeboat. I was pretty pissed off with that because I'd been in a lifeboat and I hadn't had a ride in a helicopter at that time. And then Woody, who's standing in front of me, says to Irv, you going in the helicopter or the lifeboat, mate? I said, don't know. What do you think? He said, well, I'm going in the lifeboat because in the lifeboat they give you rum. And he slid off, and that's how I got my ride in the helicopter.
It's an amazing feeling, actually, all that kind of... It wasn't panic, but it was just... fear. All of a sudden, all that was gone and you were standing on grass in a field full of cow pats, in your foul weather gear, dripping wet and a bit cold, but not too bad, making your way up some road to someone's house or some little hotel that we went to. And they gave us blankets and we all had got in a warm bath. I had a bath with my brother, actually, which was very hot. We had a hot bath together, and we were just shocked, really. Just shocked. All the effort, all the work, everything that we put into the boat had gone.
That was that, really. It was all over and done within an hour, I think. It was a very exciting hour.
Yeah.
And then we went back to a hotel, and the doctor said, you're all in shock. Whatever you do, don't drink any alcohol or do anything strenuous. And the doctor walked out, and everybody jumped over the bar and started drinking all night. So it was good fun.
If this would have happened 6 hours later in the race, past Land's End at night, up into the Irish Sea, we would have been in trouble. We would have lost some guys, for sure. We were lucky.
Just passed the place where Drum lost the keel in 1985. Capsized. The closest town is a place called Port Skeffer. Closest point, rather. And it's over there. And we passed it. And I don't know if you noticed, but the whole boat breathed a sigh of relief that sounded remarkably similar to a bottle of chilled champagne expelling its cork.
Are we going to crack open that bottle to celebrate the fact that we've got further on this race than we ever have before?
Midday.
Yes.
Oh. Meanwhile, below deck, Roger is talking with Terry about something which has been playing on Roger's mind for the past 20 years.
Of course, I would have thought Pascal was above me in the backhand, so he was actually here.
He was on the leeward side of the vessel.
That's a very comforting for me, because I thought, you know, that I didn't hear. I thought Pascal was at the backhand above me. I thought that for 20 years. And in the beginning, I had a bad conscience that I actually couldn't hear him and save him, you know, but now I realize he wasn't there.
I had a bit of a trauma going on. I couldn't have a bath for many weeks. I mean, physically, I couldn't sit in the bathtub and really feel just the water coming up to me. And to tell you the truth, I did have a few nightmares, like serious nightmares.
was fortunate enough to be going straight to the Mediterranean and joined another boat, and that night passage, I couldn't sleep below decks. I for the passage from Parma across to Sardinia, I spent the whole 24 hours on deck. It was it took a while to get over it, but...
Yeah, that's probably a good call. Phil, can we try and sneak the pole back up?
Everybody there?
What's the celebration?
That's passing the historic point where we were 20 years ago. This is uncharted territory now.
You've never been here before?
Not with drums.
Yes.
Yay!
Pole's good.
Pole for the next 10 minutes.
As you can see, the weather's a lot different to when we last did this race of 20 years ago. Last time the weather was blowing a full gale, it was absolutely miserable. About 1 mile visibility, driving rain. We had a number 5 give up, 3 reefs in the main. Today it's just like chalk and cheese. It's absolutely fantastic, and it's really good for the reunion. And the boys are all having fun and spinning her up. Rolling along.
Yeah, I was actually making a documentary about it, and I thought I was making a film about all the positive aspects of racing on the yacht Drum, and so when some little things went wrong, I decided not to make a film about that, and I was really only looking for the more positive aspects of life. But as it turned out, there wasn't any. Not in the short time that we were sailing. We'd only sailed a bit that night, and then it got dark, and I didn't film it in the dark. And in the first light, there'd been a problem with a rudder, and I didn't think that was a particularly positive thing, so I didn't film that. And then the next thing, I was lying on my bunk, and then there was a bloody great bang, and I got hit on the head by a camera case that I'd foolishly left in the wrong place. And by the time I came to, which must have been only seconds after the keeler came off, I couldn't see anyone else inside the boat. I had no idea that it was totally upside down. I had no idea.
Remember it very, very well. It was quite a sort of frightening experience for me, and one that will be with me forever. It took me a good few weeks to get over it, and even up to a year after that, I was still waking up when I was working on boats and with kind of fear about what was happening to the boat. It's something that does stay with you for a long time.
Neil, I'll just say that I've sailed a beam for the last 20 years.
Stuck in a lock-up garage in Scotland for the last 20 years, abandoned, alone.
You see the patch?
Very sad.
You see the heart patch up there?
Yeah.
Take on the heart?
The thing positively leapt out of its bag. Released.
Been through something like that with those, but you could, you know, if you didn't see them for 40 years, you'd just, hi, how are you, you know, pick up where you left off, really. And they're a special bunch of guys. Once the boat had turned turtle and we said, right, we're going to rebuild it, we've got 5 weeks to do it, nobody said, you're out of your mind, you can't be done. Everybody just said, yeah, that's what we're going to do, let's get on with it. And the next day after that, my brother and I went out to try and salvage an upside down boat, and it was in tow then. Some fishermen had got it in tow. They wanted a huge amount of money, and we said, fine, keep it. And you know, the weather got quite choppy, and they couldn't tow it. We could see that it was wrecking the back of their boat. Bits of wood were going missing because this boat was just water laden, and they were trying to tow it, and it was more the tail was wagging the dog, really. And in the end, we gave them some money and we got it back, and
the next day, really, the guys, the John Irving and the guys, were planning how to rebuild it, where to rebuild it, where to pump it out. You know, so when you get a team of people that are that positive, it's a moving experience, really. And they're a great bunch of guys. And that's proven. I mean, they're all now, 20 years on, they're running some of the biggest sailing boats in the world. Some of them are skippers. They're all doing interesting things. They're all talented guys.
Can you see any change in them over the 20 years?
No.
The first day I arrived in the Hamble, I'd been involved in the construction of the keel for Lion New Zealand, which was another Holland boat, and I got up on the scaffolding and looked in the holes where the bolt, where the keel was bolted on, and got down off there and got skip up there and said, it's not strong enough here. The welding in the top plate of the keel and the vertical webs was appeared only to be completed on the front side of the webs rather than on both sides as in Lion. And I was told that it was all strong enough and all built according to specification and to carry on with another job. So some 5 weeks later, when the keel fell off there, it was a bit of a surprise.
And looking at the watch and the time, we have to possibly to be back in Plymouth, it looks like, yeah. And we might have to put the engine on in 2 hours.
There's not much point in sitting around here for another day just flopping around, because sooner or later we're going to have to get back. And we'll do it now, and at least we'll finish the course. We might not finish the race, but we'll finish the course, and everybody will be on board.
We're going to lay the bag down, just put it straight in the bag. Take the bag. Stuff it up.
Drop it in the pit.
Well, at the moment we're in the middle of a huge high that slowly moved across, and we're literally becalmed, as you can see by the state of the water. I mean, we can keep going, or we can keep going, but it looks like it's going to be like this for at least another 24 hours. And even if we do get a little breeze in around about sunset, I should think it's going to be like this tonight.
Ah, well, I'm a bit disappointed, I have to say. It's just a pity that the pressures of life tend to get in the way of being able to complete your mission. But I fully understand, and we went into this knowing that that might happen, and so it's happened.
With a failing wind, time is rapidly running out for Drum, so she has to revert to the 1800 RPM of the iron mainsail. Once again, the race eludes them.
But yeah, seriously, taking Drum around the Fastnet Rock is a fairly emotional moment. It's you know, we struggled to get here, obviously, as is now well known, 20 years ago, and it's good to be able to get the old girl round the rock, although we haven't quite done that just yet, so that's...
In England it is 1800 up,
yeah. Yeah. But, you know, it's a piece of geography that's hitherto been beyond the boat, and now we've... now she's achieved it. So I think we can all leave her in peace after this.
Oh, you reckon they're going to leave it for miles?
Okay, we're ready to face forward.
This time.
At last, their luck changes. The wind finally picks up and allows them to sail again.
Yeah, we finally got here this time. Isn't it amazing? What a wonderful part of the race. This is fantastic.
We'll be right back.
there's a great deal to celebrate, rounding the Fastnet Rock and under sail. It's been a long time in the waiting. They may have been disqualified, but nothing was going to dampen their feeling of excitement. For them, this was their trophy, and a day they would probably never forget.
And we'll do it a few more.
I hope we do, Terry.
Hopefully
we're
alive
for
now.
I hope we do.
Next, I've got prior commitments that are just impossible to get out of. But if they wanted to do it again, certainly I'd like to have a go.
That's too much. That's too much for me.
Yeah, I'll
give
this
one
away.
Excellent. Again, the best food I've ever had on this boat.
It was obvious inside that the boat wasn't going to sink.
Well, Phil told us. He said, "Stay where you are. There's no air coming out." So that's the conversation we had with him.
No, we thought the boat was
going down.
No, the boat was kept afloat by an air pocket, but there was no air pocket. It was because it got holes through the bottom.
That's it.
Tomorrow we go to the toilet.
No, the battery. Tomorrow.
At 4 o'clock to start handling yesterday afternoon, and we motored up to the Fastnet Rock. Had no wind, but very luckily we got a little puff of wind there, and we could sail for an hour and take some pictures. And then we motored all night, and here we are, and very close to the Scilly Isles.
Drum has had to stop off at the Scilly Isles to allow Simon and his brother Johnny to fly back to London so as not to miss his pre-arranged flight to Tokyo, where he's performing with his band Duran Duran.
And it looks like we're about to go. Yeah, I'd just like to say that I'm very, very thankful for all the people that we had on the boat, the expertise and the competence, and the enormous amount of experience that we had aboard that helped us all through this.
A few of the crew are taking this opportunity of seeing Simon off and to celebrate Chaz's birthday in one of the local pubs before heading back to Plymouth. This is turning out to be some reunion.
I don't think you change that much throughout your life, that much. Unless you have personal tragedy, maybe, but, you know, we didn't suffer any personal tragedy there, so although Yanni's unfortunately died in an accident, not on drum, and that's always hard to take, you know, when you meet everybody and you have the dinner, and Yanni's not there, who was a brilliant bowman, and, you know, it's hard to believe he's gone. And a week after Nico had heard the news that Yanni had died in a motorbike accident, Nico received a postcard from Yanni saying that he'd had enough. I think he was in Argentina, or they pulled in on the race, and that he was going to come back home. And he posted that on the same day. He got killed, so it's terribly sad. It took Nico a long time, I think, but he never got over that.
The end of a grueling test, man and machine, against the elements. We
run out of tea bags.
Oh, yeah, I mean, this has just been a wonderful thing to do. I mean, to get so many diverse characters back on the boat and different lifestyles, and to have them all back together has just been a very special thing.
The final photo. But is it the final reunion? Well, we'll just have to wait and see.
This is quite amazing because we've just come in on the Fastnet race and docked 100 metres down the dock. And here's the boat that actually towed us in Falmouth 20 years ago after the boat capsized, which is a huge coincidence. And this is the second time something like this happened. In 1994, I was running a big sailing yacht, and Skip Novak said he'd like to come for a little trip with me. We left from Cowes and sailed down to Falmouth. As we docked in Falmouth, right next to us, the local dive club had found the keel, and there was Skip and I standing on the back of this big yacht, and they pulled the keel out of the water right next to us after 9 years. And now, 20 years later, we docked DRUM, and here's the boat that towed us in. It's quite amazing, really. All right.
It's not a reason to stop sailing. It's a reason to check the keel bolts.
It's a reason to check the keel bolts. It's a reason to check the keel bolts.